Yeah, today I'm gonna bring in my guest and dear friend, Fred Stewart, who's done a lot for the country and for the world, and we're gonna talk a little bit about his escrow company. So I'm gonna let the host start it off today.
Yeah, well, welcome, Fred. Thank you so much for being with us. You want to tell us a little bit about your journey, man, and how you got to where you are today?
Well, I got my journey. I've been in real estate, to my knowledge, most people's knowledge, in real estate longer than any other black real estate broker in Oregon history. I got into real estate when I was 23 in 1988. Wow. I was just a baby. And though, you know, I just gotten out of the Marines, so I didn't feel like a baby, you know.
Right.
Definitely didn't feel like a baby. But looking back, I was a baby. So I started my real estate career in 1988. My primary focus was selling homes in the inner north and northeast Portland, which was, you know, much more complicated back then than today. Today it's so simple.
That's well, because there's such a high demand today, right? It's insane.
Well, when I got into real estate, there was about 500 vacant and abandoned homes in inner northeast Portland. Wow. In other words, nobody was living there. Nobody. We had squatters that were welcomed.
you know?
It was like they'd rather have a squatter in the house than, let's say, you know, and I can't say all squatters were good, but there were a lot of good squatters. There were people who lived in these homes sometimes 10, 15 years, didn't own them, didn't pay rent. They were just, you know, they just took it over. Right. And the owners were just happy they didn't have to show up to cut grass anymore. You know what I mean?
They okay,
so out. Their parents had died. And, you know, they find out one day somebody moved in, you know, grandma's house, or you know what I mean? And they're like, oh, cool. As long as they cut the grass and I don't get calls, we're cool. Houses weren't worth a lot. The average market time for a home in inner northeast Portland in 1988 was 18 months.
Really?
We have houses that have been on the market for over 5 years.
Right.
When I got into the business. 5 years.
Right.
We had prostitution and pimps and gangbangers here. We had pimps that would just take over a house and put girls in it.
And so you as the real estate agent, they're like, okay, Fred, we're going to give you this house. Good luck, man. You got to talk to the pimps. You got to get them out of there.
Yeah, you got to talk to the pimps, the drug dealers.
He tell you some real stuff. He tell you some real stuff, Christian, because when I was a kid, I remember that, like, sometimes when I go through Northeast right now, Fred, I'd be like, man, you know how many dead bodies and how many abandoned houses these used to be. They didn't even want to live in this neighborhood.
Really?
Yeah.
And now
it was like
these houses are going for like
$500,000.
You'd be
surprised how often we sell homes for $800,000+.
Wow.
I've seen homes that I sold for $10,000 and was happy to do it. Right? Happy to do it. Oh, I sold that. Hell, I look at homes that I gave away on blind assumptions.
Wow.
Gave away. We used to have this thing called blind assumptions. FHA and VA loans they allowed blind assumptions up until about 1996. Then they kind of got rid of them, you know what I mean? And but you didn't even need to qualify for the loan as long as you're 18 years old and didn't have any judgments against you. Your credit didn't matter. You didn't even need to have a job. You just needed to be 18 and above and no judgments.
Well, you see, that's what's tricky with the older generation in power right now. They think like, oh, you should be able to pull yourself by your bootstrap, you know, buy your house and pay your way through college with a gas station job, you know.
Whereas, why I slapped guys like that around, because I said, come on, guys, before 1990 in Portland, 65% of all residential real estate transactions were seller financing. Sellers would make a deal with the owner of the property. And a lot of times there was no down payment necessary. A lot of times there was, but nothing like today. You know what I mean? And the terms, I've seen I've seen deals done between sellers and a buyer where the person made their payments every quarter.
Wow.
You know what I'm talking about? So instead of a monthly payment, and people used to freak out. They go, man, I got to come up with $1,600 every 3 months. But you see, the thing is, for some people, especially people in businesses like, you know, bartending, waitressing, whatever, it's easier to pay their payment quarterly than monthly because of the ups and downs of the week. You know what I'm talking about? So you got a guy everybody has those up and downs. You have emergencies or whatever. Well, for a lot of people, it was just flat easier to pay it quarterly than monthly. And I've even seen where people will pay a payment once every 6 months.
Right. Well, let me ask you this, Fred. In the 90s, there was a mayor here who famously kind of turned things around. And so what made Portland this crazy magnet to where these houses are selling for millions of dollars? And
it started back in the 1960s. And in the 90s, I mean, we were lucky. I tell everybody we were very lucky. That every mayor we had from 1956 to Vera Katz, from Terry Schrunk to Vera Katz, the citizens of Portland won the lottery. We really did. Great mayors. People don't understand that the 1956 election in Portland was basically a civil war. We became progressive post-56. If Schrunk hadn't have won, we wouldn't have the Portland we have today. We wouldn't.
Incredible. Was he just more focused on the people and validating the regular person over, you know, selling?
Dude, that's a whole show in itself. I'll just say he was a little different. He was a criminal, just like Robert Kennedy said. You know, everything Robert Kennedy said about Terry Schrunk. But you couldn't be influential in Portland back then and not be a bit of a criminal.
Yeah, well, you had to know the scene, right?
And for a few dollars more. you know, he was a hero, an anti-hero, but we couldn't be. You wouldn't have had a Neil Goldschmidt if you hadn't had a Terry Schrunk. Wouldn't have had it, and we wouldn't have had. Didn't have Neil Goldschmidt, there would have never been a Charles Jordan. Charles Jordan would have never. He didn't want the job when he was first offered it to.
So, what do you think the times from now and then are, you know, better now, or was it better then when you were in it? Because you've been in it.
We've been progressively not electing the right people for the city council. I got a full disclosure. I've run for it twice. You got to remember, I voted every single election. So a lot of these people I voted for too. You know what I mean? Except I didn't vote against myself when I ran, but I voted in every other election. You know, and I will say I'm guilty of it too. So when I do the full disclosure, I'm guilty of it too, because there are people I voted for that won, and I made a mistake. Okay, I did. As a matter of fact, the last guy I ran against, Steve Novick, I supported him wholeheartedly in 2012. That was a mistake.
Well, let me ask you, Fred, by mistake, what do you want to see in a leader? And also, if you were given the job, like you said, you wanted it, what would you do?
That literally puts Portland today first and the future second. The problem is, since about 2004, we got a bunch of people who get on board trying to build the city of tomorrow. Whereas what they should be doing, like the old guys did, build a city that's comfortable today, that there's a benefit for tomorrow. You see what I'm talking about?
What's a tangible example of a choice like that?
Oh, look at the housing. Dude, there is no way the old city commissioners and mayors would have allowed housing in Portland get this bad. We've had three major housing crises in Portland history, the biggest of which was during World War II. And look what they did. They built Gill's Lake. They built Vanport. There's a bunch of other things that they did to address housing. They outlawed rent control. Why did they outlaw rent control? Because rent control gets in the way of financing new housing.
Right.
You know what I mean? It gets in the way of financing new housing. So they said, no, we're not going to do that. Get my meaning? Even though, you know, at the time, I mean, these were considered progressive thoughts, progressive ways. That's why I look at a lot of guys today that say, I'm a progressive, and I go, prove it. You know what I mean? Just because you don't call me the N-word, you know, I look at your Facebook page. I don't see no black folks on your Facebook page other than the usual suspects. I mean, this one guy, I was teasing him. I said, you know, every black person that you've got on your Facebook page, they have the same white friends. Right. You know, it's like you guys.
It's like Bradley Cooper. He shows up everywhere.
Yeah, you share the same black folk. I wish you guys would have some like different black folk. I ain't saying I should be your friend because you get on my nerves, but I'm just saying it's like, okay, because he's friends with this white guy who's a progressive, other white people who want to be in politics say, this black guy needs to be my friend too.
What do you think about, do you,
and then you get the
do you feel comfortable speaking?
That just cracks me up.
Do you feel comfortable speaking a little bit about your active days in the military as a Marine?
Well, no, my active days was not that impressive. I was lucky to be there. It was fun. I mean, I enjoyed being a Marine. I was in the Marines from 83 to I started processing out in 1988, processed out officially in 1989. And you loved being a Marine.
Yeah, you must have learned a lot of stuff.
I didn't go to war. I didn't go to war, though I trained for it. All of my war stories involve either booze, women, and ignorance, and sometimes all three.
Well, you got to travel the world, though, right, as a Marine?
I left the continental United States in a way. There was one time I spent, 24 hours on a C-130. God knows where we flew. But we landed. We took off in California. And landed in California. So, you know, for all I know, we were just going in circles, you know, in the ocean.
Right.
But,
right.
I think the furthest the Marines ever took me out of mainland United States is Hawaii. You know, no, I mean, I was in during the party years. You know what I mean? We didn't have a war going on. We trained, we drank, and we chased women. Wow.
Yeah.
What a life.
And today, a lot of that knowledge you've applied, so you got your own escrow company, correct?
Well, yeah, I started the escrow company because you got to remember, I've been in real estate since 1988. I've sold, you know, almost 800 homes in Portland. Well, in Northeast Portland. I've sold over 800 homes in the state of Oregon. But in the Northeast Portland, I've sold almost 800 addresses. I've been involved in about 1,300 transactions. I also spent 5 years in banking. I worked for Macquarie Bank Limited for 5 years in their mortgage division mostly. I worked there for 5 years and I closed, somewhere right around 3,000 or 4,000 transactions, something like that. And then I went back into real estate. And so I've been around, I mean, I've been involved in public stuff, like, you know, I was on the Portland Bureau Budget Advisory Committee for 5 years. I investigated cops on PIAC, the Portland City of Portland, for 5 years. I was president of King Neighborhood Association. I was on the Metro Future Vision Committee, which was a visioning committee they created when they changed their charter in the mid-90s. I've been on about 10 or 15 other committees around the city during the 90s and early 2000s and stuff like that. And so I've been around, I've been involved in a lot of stuff. I've sold real estate, high, commercial, low, residential. And I've done, you know, work with the public. I've represented everybody from just, single mothers and mom and pops to federal and state and local government. So I've been around. Not too many people in real estate, period, have had a career as expansive as mine. So why did I start this title company? I started out starting this title company because when I first got into real estate, a lot of things were local. We had a company called Oregon Title Company, and it was a different touch. You know what I mean? Everything from the way they dressed to the way they treated people was very local. You know what I mean?
Right.
I remember I had a closing with Oregon Title where the escrow officer knew the owner of the property, knew they were a little older. This is before, now we do remote all the time. But she says, you know, Fred, what I'm going to do is they're not far from my mom's house. I got to go pick up my mom to go grocery shopping. I'm going to stop over at their house because I know them and have them sign. You know what I mean? There is that personal connection. Right. We don't have that in Portland. It's very corporate. Our escrow and title companies are very efficient. That's good. But they're also very antiseptic. You know what I'm talking about? It's kind of like, well, come in here, give me a lot of money, get the hell out.
Well, Fred, you know, the way you see things are going, man, do you think Portland will experience a bubble, or do you think this growth is just going to keep going? Because
that's why I tell my friends and family and their kids to buy as much as they can. There can't be a bubble. People have been claiming that Portland has had a bubble since the 1850s. See, the problem people don't look at is they don't pull out their calculators when they're looking at Portland, and you need to. Portland is a top 20 market in the United States. I think it's actually 20, right? It's a top 20 market, but it's the cheapest of the top 30 markets to live in.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, and it's the cheapest flat out for a city this class on the West Coast. And people say, well, I don't think so. Well, okay, find a city that's cheaper. Is Sacramento cheaper? No. Is Seattle cheaper? No. Let's go to Tacoma, Washington. Is that cheaper? No. Well, they go, well, there's Olympia. I said, Olympia is not in the top 30.
Right, right.
You know, I mean, Olympia is a nice town. Don't get me wrong. But it's not a city like Portland. You know, I said, okay, let's go further in California. Where in the San Francisco Bay market can you go and it's cheaper than Portland? And no, people can scratch it. One guy threw out Bakersfield to me, which cracked me up. And by the way, he was wrong, because Bakersfield is more expensive. But the thing is, you know how far Bakersfield is from San Francisco?
Like, you know, 3 hours.
Yeah, that's what I mean. I was cracking up. I go, dude. I said, no, this is the problem that people don't understand. We are the cheapest market. And we happen to be more progressive than we're not. I mean, we're not as progressive as we used to be. We're not. We've got a lot of fakers around here. You know what I mean? Sure. We got a lot of guys that says, hey, I'm progressive. Yeah, really? Uh-huh. Yeah, David Duke likes you. Does that make you progressive? You know what I mean? The policies you have are pretty you know, divisive and pretty, you know, negative toward people who aren't rich. You know, so, yeah, you're progressive, all right. I'm looking for that progressive that David Duke hates. You know what I mean? David Duke doesn't like you. You know, that's the guy I'm looking for.
Exactly.
You
know? True.
And I it's funny. I tell people, I go, guys, there is no bubble. It's like anything. Real estate will go up sometimes, will go down. But if you look at the arc of real estate in Portland over the last 40 years, it blows out everybody on the West Coast. When you talk about what it costs to buy in, we've had markets go higher, but the buy-in was also higher.
Right.
So if you look at the cost of buy-in, now think about it. There are people in this town who in 1990 paid 10 grand for a house and still has it. And that house might be worth as much as 2 million bucks, depending on what neighborhood you're in.
Right.
Find a city in the West Coast where that has happened.
No. Okay. Well, so it's definitely a good call that, you know, Portland will be a bubble, you know, will be a place where people are going to flock to, because California is getting less habitable. The weather is getting nicer here. You know, global warming is actually helping a little bit. Two things I want to ask you about. Where do you think in general the U.S. currency is going to be at, you know, when eventually China, you know, becomes a more powerful country, perhaps?
Well, right now, what makes our money so powerful is the stability of our economy. And we still, even over China, even though China is technically wealthier than the United States is right now, I don't know if you knew that was the World Bank has declared that. Their market is not as stable.
Okay.
We are about 100 years ahead of China in stability of market. That means resiliency. You understand? It is not an easy feat for our market to go up or down. You see what I mean? It's Yeah. It's massive. It's like moving the moon. You know what I mean?
Right.
But that will change one day. There will be a country. It could be India.
Oh, you know they're ahead of us technology, right?
You know what, guy? I'm going to tell you, don't ever believe for a second anybody's ahead of the United States on technology, because the United States is good at lying and BS better than everybody else. You know what I mean? And I will tell you, there may be things that is going on in America that we're not aware of, and that may be the intention. You know what I mean? One of my favorite stories, I actually heard this story first time from Stanfield Turner. You should look him up sometime. He had a book, he was on a book tour, and he was telling us about how John F. Kennedy was totally embarrassed when he found out that Sputnik was a planned thing by Eisenhower, that we had our satellite prepared and ready to go close to a year before Sputnik.
Really?
But the President Eisenhower specifically ordered for us to wait for the Russians to throw theirs up, because they knew the Russians were just throwing up a basketball that went beep, beep. We had a camera on ours.
Right.
You understand? So Eisenhower said, no, we're going to go second, because while they're laughing at us and talking about how badass they are, we're going to take a picture of everything they got. Now, I heard this from Stanfield Turner, who, when you read the Wikipedia page, you're going to learn he's kind of with the CIA for a little bit. So he said everybody was mad at Eisenhower. And they were like, no way, we got to go first. But after the rocket went up, I mean, second, you know, our rocket went up, and we got all these beautiful pictures of Russia, you know, and he goes, then we understood the brilliance. Well, the reason I'm telling a story, there's hundreds of stories about the United States like that. The United States, the way we look at it, it's a country that always does what it does in its own best interest. Right. And what that story was talking about, it was not in our best interest to be number one. So if we're right now, if you feel China's number one, I'm guaranteeing you there may be a reason for that.
I see.
There may be. Well, it could be true. You know, time will tell. Hopefully I live long enough to find out what the truth is. But I'll just say, from my vantage point, I'm not going to concede anything until I get overwhelming evidence.
Because
we're dealing with forces and people, you know, that are dealing on a different, I won't say different level, but they're dealing in different circles than you and I are. You know, so I just focus on my circles. Like, nobody saw me creating this title company until I did it. You know, this is the first Black-owned escrow and title company west of the Mississippi. Absolute first one in Oregon and Washington.
Wow.
It's never been done before.
It's incredible, man.
You know, and think about it. We talk about states like Texas and California. There's a few Black people down there.
Right. Many.
You know, how come not there? How come not Denver? You know, it's just kind of humbling for me sometimes when I think, why me? Why am I? But I didn't start it to be the first Black one. I didn't even know until I got into it and it was pointed out to me.
Have you thought about getting back into
that was local
to mayor, to being the mayor? You think about running that again?
No, not right now. I think I can do better to help my city, because the only time I ran for the city of, council is I just felt that was the best thing for me and best thing for the city. I thought I could add a lot to the city, but I think I can add more doing this. You know what I mean?
I see.
It's not that I don't think I couldn't do the job. I mean, I'm definitely, I think, smart enough, but, you know, where is my talents better, you know, applied? If I can get more Black people involved in escrow and title and in banking and in real estate, if I can get, you know, white people more comfortable developing relationships with Black people, you know, what's better, to do that or to be mayor?
That's a good point, man.
You know, so I mean, I'm right now, I'm not really thinking about anything political. What I want to do every day is grow this company and make it something that the people in Portland, people I've grown up with, the people that I went to school with, people I was in the military with, people I sold homes to, I want them to feel good that they had this relationship with me. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And they trust you.
That's what I focus on. That's what I focus on, because, you know, politics, it comes and goes. You know what I mean? There's a lot of great things our politicians have done. And let's just say nobody remembers.
Right.
But we remember.
You know, that's very noble of you, Fred, because, you know, you're looking out for the community as opposed to, you know, what it looks like on the surface. Because, you know, people use their ego and they say, oh, well, I want to be mayor. I want everybody to see me. But, you know, there's that saying that a great man does not ask to lead. He is asked to lead. You know, so maybe no, one day you'll be
approached. The last time I ran for city council, I ran because, and I got what I wanted. I thought Steve Novick was an absolute fraud as a progressive. I thought he was an absolute fraud. I saw nothing but a guy going to work every day and pissing on my city. And I just wanted him out of here. Right. And I lost. I lost to a white supremacist, but I still got what I wanted. You know what I mean? Right. If Steve Novick had been a good city commissioner, I would have never run. I voted for the guy.
But we didn't know. You know?
Yeah. I thought he would be great. When I heard that Steve was going to run for city council, I thought we were going to get back on track again. Because the vision you have of a guy like Steve Novick is the vision of the type of people that used to run for city council and win. You know what I mean? The Gretchen Cafouris, the Margaret Strongs, the Mike Lindberghs. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, the list goes on. We had some incredible people go into that position, and they attracted. And so that's another thing people don't understand. Those people attracted even more incredible people. If you think the city commissioners were badass, I could name some names of some people they attracted to our government. And that's the problem. The critical problem that we got with the city council right now is they don't keep and they don't attract in general the best people in the room to serve our city. You know what I mean? Good people, and I'm not putting on the people that are there, because some of them are there because they're trying to weather the storm. They're hoping there's going to be a change. But we got an awful lot of bad people that get paid every 2 weeks from our city, and they're attracted by bad people. You know what I mean? And I'm not going to mention which city commissioners are the worst. You know, I've already mentioned one, and they're not a city commissioner anymore. But what I'm getting to is, that's why it's important when we do vote for a city commissioner or any candidate, but especially important when our former government, you're not just voting for that individual. You're voting for the people that they will hire, people who are attracted, the people that call up and say, I want to work for you. I don't want to just work for the city. I want to work for you. You see what I'm talking about? Right. Who they can recruit. And we don't have people right now that are attracting that class of people that we used to, recruit, used to have. And that's very important. No one city commissioner or mayor who is a city commissioner can run the city on their own. You got to have a very healthy, very strong, very intellectually minded and disciplined bureaucracy. You do. People like to ignore those folks, but those are the hard workers. You know what I mean? Those are the worker bees. And we're not attracting the right people to go into that area. And for good reason. I'm not putting those folks down. I mean, I don't blame them. You know what I mean? I can understand why somebody will go, I'm going to look for another city. You know what I mean? It's not like they kill themselves because they can't work for Portland. They just find another place that is more receptive to their talents. You know what I mean?
What kind of environment would attract those people to come back? What would it mean to be more receptive to those kinds of talents?
First off, intellectually inclusive. Yeah, that's the first one. Intellectually inclusive. We got a lot of people who we elect who think that they know everything. You know, I tell people I grew up around city commissioners and mayor. I've met every city commissioner and mayor, you know, since 1976. And I said, you know, the guys we got right now, they ask so few questions. So few questions, and their feelings get hurt so much. You know what I mean? It's so easy to offend them. Whereas the old
we got 2 minutes, you guys. 2 minutes.
The old city commissioners used to go out and ask questions all the time, and they'd get in arguments. And I mean, they would look for that person who knew that one extra thing that they didn't know. You know what I mean? We don't have that anymore. And the other thing that we need is we need people who aren't afraid. Ready for this? They're not afraid to get their asses kicked in the public. If you're a good city commissioner or mayor, and if you're good, 50% of the people are going to like what you're doing and 50% are going to dislike what you're doing at any given moment. And that's just how the life goes. Right. You know, it's a tough job. Mm-hmm. It's the toughest political job in the state. Stop being a crybaby. We got a lot of crybabies. You know?
Yeah.
So, true. Those are the two things that minimum. There's like three or four others, but we only have a minute probably left.
Yeah. Great, man. Well, thank you, Fred. What were you going to say, Antonio?
No, yeah, I was just soaking up that knowledge from old Fred. It's always a pleasure hearing him talk because he's an elder who's been around a corner, a few corners, you know, and going down that lane that I'm headed. So, you know, I appreciate it. You know, I can look back on this.
You got a good legacy to build on, man. Your grandfather was a great man, smart man.
Thank you, brother.
And I love talking about it.
Yeah, the first accountant and owner.
Yep.
Yep.
First one.
Yep, from here, from Portland.
Hey, only one.
Yep.
Yeah.
Still to this day.
To this day, the only one.
All right, you guys. Well, we'll get you back on, Fred, and see how that company's going for you.
Good. We're in operations right now. Vanport Escrow and Title, located in North Portland.